My name is Bajo. Since childhood, I've been obsessed by a controversial global phenomenon. My obsession took me to the ABC, where I, along with my partner Hex, investigated video games through the auspices of a unit known as the Good Game Files. Through this unit, we continue to play video games without having to get real jobs that matter, like doctors or barristers or baristas. In 2015, we went off air and our video game reviews ceased, but our personal obsession did not.
Hey, Bajo, what are you doing in here? Are you aware your office is on fire?
Everything is under control, Hex. Just fetch me some water.
Bajo, it's too late. Just get out of here.
It's all right, Hex. They're not fired. They're just interdimensional beings who are trying to communicate by burning me. Welcome to Good Game. I'm Bajo.
And I'm Hex.
And we're back, and it's so nice to be sharing the den of gaming with you once more, Hex.
Oh, likewise, Bajo. Good to be back in the gaming groove.
Yes, and 2016 is already off to a flying start.
Yeah, so many games to talk about, which is why tonight's episode is a full 1 hour of Good Game. We've got reviews of the charming platformer Unravel. From the creator of Braid, there's The Witness. We go on an emotional journey in That Dragon Cancer.
Will he weep for him as he did for Lazarus? Will he weep for me?
And we see how long we can survive in XCOM 2.
Goose will join us to talk about some of the games that came out over the break. Plus, he has a story for us on the most successful indie developer hub in Australia.
It was created as a home, a place where they could get together, they could collaborate, and have all this creative knowledge in one place and work together.
Something new to the show this year, Good Game Pocket's NichBoy is going to be taking us on some regular first plays. Tonight, he dives into the Division beta.
We're dealing with... Can you hear me?
What did you get up to over the break, Hex?
I ate a lot, specifically of breakfast, and I took photos of all of it.
Oh, nice. I reorganized my gaming room, so I put my monitor on this big swinging arm, so now I can move the monitor out of the way and use mouse and keyboard on the big TV in front of it. The dream, Hex, the dream.
I don't know, I'm still a dual screens girl.
Controversial. Mm. Well, enough of all this. Can you name the game for this week?
I guess you're the f***ing new guy, huh?
At last year's E3, amongst all of the adrenaline-fueled action, there was one game that stood out for appearing distinctly more gentle and from the heart. That game was Unravel, and now we're finally able to go on Yanni's adventure.
This game is adorable.
It's beautiful, isn't it? You can tell it's come from such a small, passionate team because it has a real focus to it. It's uncluttered, it's not afraid to be subtle, and it's frequently clever.
And Yanni is just so instantly likable too. And I think it's because his design is just so simple. It's all you need. There's nothing to be annoyed by. No unnecessary squeaky voice, no goofy animation. He's just the cute little toy that you might have had as a child.
Yeah, I can't wait to see people cosplaying as him, walking around like giant red woolly mummies. I mean, basically this whole game is charming.
Yeah, Unravel is essentially a side-scrolling platformer packed full of puzzles, which are all solved by Yanni's ability to lasso his red yarn on things. You can swing from point to point, yank on objects, build springy bridges. And there's a combination of these talents that you'll discover as you play and crack the puzzles.
Yeah, and there are some realistic physics in there too. So things will roll or float, and that makes stumbling upon solutions pretty intuitive as you push and poke your way around to get Yanni from point A to point B. I found solving the game's puzzles pretty satisfying, but there is a fair bit of trial and error in there, isn't there?
Yeah, that sort of gameplay where you get stuck in a loop can get irritating. You just don't know if you've got the solution wrong or you're just executing the moves poorly, and I found that frustrating. The controls are good though, they actually feel really fluid. But getting the timing right on some of those solutions is tricky.
Yeah, there were times when I'd get through a puzzle and think, I'm sure there was a more correct way of doing that, but whatever works. I never lost my patience, though.
Yeah, some of the puzzles are great, but every time Yanni got stuck in water and died, I found myself getting angry. I'd always be trying to climb up out of it, but no. So does Yanni have lungs?
Deadly video game water, Barjo, it strikes again.
Maybe he's all soggy and just can't move, I guess.
Just too absorbent. That's not the only danger, though. There's also wildlife to be wary of in a few levels. Gophers and crabs.
There was this one section where you get picked off by crows, unless you're undercover at the right time, and it just felt really random. There was no real pattern to their swooping, and it wasn't clear what you were meant to do there anyway. I think the game is prone to a bit of this at times.
Yeah, it's hard to stay angry at Unravel for too long though, don't you think? I just found there were so many great little moments and puzzles that make you say, wow, that's really cool and very smart. Something that adds a twist to the exploration is that Yanni will occasionally run out of yarn. So you see him straining and you can't go any further unless you find a fresh clump of yarn to absorb, and these act as checkpoints. It's so sad seeing him all skinny and threadbare.
He's a fragile little guy, isn't he? Can't survive high falls either. Sometimes I found myself carefully easing him over ledges with the yarn like some sort of abseiler. That whole yarn mechanic is definitely a success. It works so well.
Yeah, it's quite beautiful the way it drapes along and gets all crisscrossed throughout the level. Story-wise, it's like you're threading your way through someone's childhood memories. You sometimes glimpse these apparitions in the background, and when you finish a level, it unlocks pictures in a family photo album, as if you're reawakening something that was lost.
There's also a pretty clear message about the importance of protecting the environment, and we won't spoil the way the game reveals that to you, but I like the way it was handled. It was touching and not preachy.
Yeah, I agree, and I want people to discover Yanni's adventure for themselves, because this is definitely worth playing, I think. It's just got so much heart, and it's been created with such care.
It's reasonably priced too, and you know, this is a fun and charming game while it lasted, but I don't think it's gonna stick in my mind forever.
Yeah, and look, it may not be as essential as something like Journey, for example, but I do think Coldwood Interactive has created something quite special with this, so I'd recommend it. I'm giving it 4.
I'm giving it 3 stars. If you've been watching our online daily show, Good Game Pocket, then you'll be familiar with NichBoy's insightful first impressions on all the latest games.
Yes, and he's so darn good at it that we've asked him to bring us a first play here every Tuesday night, starting right now with Ubisoft's The Division.
Tom Clancy's The Division is slated for release March 8th this year, but Ubisoft have run a beta to let players stress test the game before it comes out. I was lucky enough to be chosen for that beta, and as of the time of recording, it is still live. Now, a little bit of scene setting. A virus has been released in New York City. My character went on a half-hour jog from a helicopter to find his base of operations, which seems to be pretty run down. So we're now going to pick it up at the beginning of one of the missions to rebuild this base. Let's dive in. Okay, so this is my base of operations. I've got a tech wing, a medical wing, and a security wing, but they're all offline. Let's go outside and find us a New York doctor, like House or McDreamy. I assume they're in New York. They're in America, at least. It's a pretty small place. So this is the streets. Everything looks quite empty, and that is a bit of a running theme here, is that there's not a lot of people on the streets because House can't cure them all.
I spent 6 years in medical school. I don't give a shit what you saw on TV while you were jerking off to soap operas in your mom's basement, but setting a bone isn't pretty.
None of that is safe for television.
We've got a rioter takeover at Madison Square Garden. The JTF and Sarah were using the site as a field hospital, but armed hostiles swarmed in.
Okay, so we gotta go get Girl House. Now, who's a good female doctor? We gotta go get the Mindy Project. And it's here. It was literally across the street. I don't know why I'm the one who has to go do this.
We're holding Dr. Candle and her staff. We need those personnel back in the base so we can get the medical wing.
Okay, take cover. Take cover, buddy. Can't take cover against a glass wall? That's probably a good idea. Okay, heal up. Use a med kit. Lots of the HUD is AR. Like, you've got your health, your ammo, you've got this line that shows you where you're supposed to be going. A lot of it is AR stuff. I don't quite know how it gels in with the game, because he doesn't seem to be wearing any AR technology on his face. So I don't know how he sees any of this, but I see it, and I feel like that's what's most important. Okay, this is what you do. You enter, you sweep the area. You then attack that guy's face, and you take him down, like our boss. Hey. Oh! Oh, the problem was you stuck your head right up in front of the bullets. All right, Mindy, I'm coming, baby.
Hatched in. Let's see what I can find.
Yeah, there she is. There she is. There she is. That's her. Now, I've got a variety of weapons. I've got, like, an assault rifle. I've got what appears to be, I think, a submachine gun. And then I've got a handgun. If I hit E, I send out a pulse that detects all evil people within the area. They call them threats. I call them bad men. Oh, he dropped a smoke grenade because I shot him in the hand. That's a great move. Oh, they just keep coming, don't they? All from that one spot. You know, if you all ganged up on me at the same time, you'd probably have a much better chance. Run away from the grenade!
Candle and her staff are still upstairs, stashed in the kitchen at Kobe's.
So because I did so well in my little firefight, I've unlocked a new ability here. You can see the three tech trees, medical, tech, and security. They're the wings, obviously, in the base that I'm unlocking. These are the things that make me a better fighter. You've also got talents, which is an even bigger skill tree, and you've got perks as well. So there's a lot to unlock here as you level up. He deserved it. He knows what he did. Hey, talk to me, Mindy.
Keep your heads down and keep it quiet.
Heads?
Warning, hostiles detected.
Let's see how many people we're dealing with. Papa, can you hear me? Right, so guys with baseball bats are ballsy.
The escort party's taking heavy fire from the roof. They can't move until you get up there and take down that gunner.
Secure the roof.
We're pinned down.
Okay, so that we want to stop that helicopter from getting shot. Grenade, you guys. I assume they're both dead. A real soldier never looks. Something that I do appreciate here is there's a lot of detail. There's like a guitar here. They were having like a kumbaya session before I came and shut the place up. Baseball bat guys, when will you learn? It's like they think the bullets are a ball and they just can't hit fast enough. All right, I'm gonna flank these guys. Oh, you just got flanked, son. You got mad flanked. Oh, in the face.
Candle and all staff accounted for. No casualties.
Let's pick up whatever green glowing thing you were carrying.
Wish I could have had your back out there, but I think we make a hell of a team anyway.
Okay, heading back to base. We talk to Mindy. She gives me a lollipop. Job done.
Thanks for getting me out of the garden. I've been in some hostile work environments before, but Jesus.
Sarah is pretty sure Dr. Gordon Amherst had something to do with the outbreak.
Oh, Gordon.
I need to talk to him. Anything of his you can find. Notebooks, laptops, close personal friends, I need that too. And we need to talk about live samples and antibodies. You're gonna be busy.
Okay, mission complete. I've saved the sassy doctor and she's given me a new objective. Find what I presume is another sassy doctor. And that's something about this game that's quite apparent. You're getting these missions that spawn other missions that spawn other missions. It has a real MMO vibe. And I'm happy about that because I actually love MMOs. I like, as boring as it is for some people, the numbers going up, the things getting slightly better with every single time. However, the thing I'm a little concerned about after my first hour with the beta is that compared to other MMOs, The Division feels very empty at the moment. The best MMOs feel alive, the environments feel varied, and it always feels like there are, you know, groups of creatures and strange people and NPCs and stuff wandering around everywhere, and also there are other people wandering around everywhere. Obviously, this is just a beta, but in my whole hour of playing it, I've only seen one other person in the world at all. Now, there is the Dark Zone, which is entirely devoted to PvP, but I would love to see New York recovering from this virus outbreak with other people wandering around all the time. While the environments look beautiful, it's more that they feel cluttered. It doesn't feel alive, it just feels kind of full of stuff. So that was my first play of the Division beta. Will there be a second play when the game comes out? Yeah, I think there will be. There's enough here to draw me through, and I'm really keen to see how the game expands on the promises it's made. What I would like to see, though, is more interaction with other players in the environment, and that my contribution to rebuilding New York City extends beyond just this small base, and instead I see my actions reflected in the rest of the city.
So now it's time to talk about the games we played over the break, and joining us is Goose.
Thanks, guys. Good to be back.
Hi, Goose. How's it going?
Good.
Well, I was going to play a whole bunch of Xenoblade Chronicles X over the break, and then Dragon's Dogma on PC came out, and I played about 100 hours of that instead. It's so much fun.
Oh, man. I loved Dragon's Dogma when that game first came out. So with this new PC release, I've seen a lot of people getting into it online, and I'm so happy.
Yeah, it's a good release. Like, the textures are good. It runs well. It looks smooth. It looks much better than it did when it came out on console.
Yeah, it used to run like a dog, didn't it?
Yeah. It was a bit rough.
So many jaggies. What I love about it is how Souls-ish it is. I kind of forgot how Souls-ish it is thematically and how tough it is. And I just love that you can grab onto anything and hang on, although if you do that on the flying beast, I forgot they just fly off and then drop you.
Yeah, my main memory of Dragon's Dogma was that you don't want to be caught in the forest at night.
Yeah.
Bad.
That's dodgy.
And it is tough. It's a brutally hard game as well, isn't it?
And so is the DLC. I wandered into the DLC and thought, okay, this is going all right. I killed a few enemies, and then this happened. And death killed me in one hit, and I said, maybe you should go away. But solid PC release. I highly recommend it. One of the best RPGs out there.
Well, speaking of brutally tough games, I sunk a lot of time these holidays into Darkest Dungeon, which is a roguelike dungeon crawler that is brutally hard.
Are you a fan of roguelikes in general?
Yeah, they're fun ones to keep coming back to, and in particular this one, which has a beautiful art style, and you create a party of four heroes, and you then take them through randomly generated dungeons that are brutally hard. In fact, I customized the party after the good game team, so I had all of us in there, and I got us all killed a lot. So, yeah, sorry. There's a lot of things going on under the hood, including the fact that all your heroes will become incredibly stressed, and they'll actually develop conditions like kleptomania and fear, and they'll start attacking each other, and you have to take them back to town and remedy them in the tavern or in the sanitarium. So it's quite a dark game, as the name suggests.
So you're stressed, your characters are stressed, everything's stressful. Sounds fun, Goose.
Yeah, including even at one point there was a chance to have your heroes rest by a campfire, which I thought would be a great way to earn some XP and get some health back, and the torches all blew out, everyone started panicking, and Hex's character actually had a heart attack.
What?
Yeah.
What an anticlimactic end to my adventure.
Yeah, I'll have to make a new hero for you, sorry.
Yeah, maybe someone with better cardiovascular health.
See what I can do.
They're cursed champion falls.
There's a lot of people talking about this game. It's got a lot of buzz. Why is it so popular?
I think it even has a warning at the start saying how hard it is every time you boot the game up to tell you this is a tough game and everything in it is trying to kill you. So I think people are really enjoying that. There's a lot of gluttons for punishment out there.
Well, I've been playing a bit of Assassin's Creed Chronicles India, which is kind of a 2.5D puzzle platformer, sort of an offshoot from the main franchise. And the first thing I want to say about that is I hope they don't exclude India as a possible location from the main franchise now, because it is so beautiful. It'd be such a great setting. But if this is your first Assassin's Creed Chronicles game, I'd say you just have to really get used to an entirely new set of rules. You can't rely on combat the way you may have in the main games. If you take on more than one enemy, for example, you're going to die. It's much more about stealth and puzzle solving.
Yeah, it's interesting that this franchise is now kind of being split into these two categories of games, almost like this serves as a bit of a palate cleanser in between the big open world games.
Yeah, I think it's the right move though, because, you know, we've often complained about the oversaturation of these games and just feeling like you're doing the same thing over and over again. This definitely does feel like a bit of a breath of fresh air.
It's too many. They're going to run out of genres. They're going to run out of settings.
Well, clearly not. I mean, there's a lot of countries in the world.
What's left? Okay, they might do a primal. Maybe they'll do a Assassin's Creed primal.
They might do Blood Dragon.
If they do, like, a space one, then I'm going to get really excited.
Space! Assassin's Creed Space!
Yeah. Assassin's Creed Mars.
Yeah, that would be cool.
Yeah.
I think with this one, the levels that I enjoyed the most were the ones that had a bit of kind of platforming and timing involved in the puzzles, rather than there were a few levels there that just had, like, you know, a gazillion guards that you had to strategically take out to move on. But I mean, overall I enjoyed it.
Do you think you'll keep playing it?
Yeah, I mean, it's really, it's good level of challenge, I think. So, you know, that's always a plus.
Well, this was nice, guys.
Yeah, we should do this again.
Yeah.
I don't know why I'm sitting like this.
I don't know if I'm even in that camera, I was thinking.
The Witness is developer Jonathan Blow's first new game since he created the puzzle platformer Braid all the way back in 2008. And wasn't it incredible, Hex?
Yes, if you're going to make a debut game, make it that good. The Witness is just as ambitious. When you begin, you find yourself emerging into a lush, deserted island, with no introduction or story to say who you are, where you are, or why you're there, which creates this really cool air of mystery. You know, you instantly want to explore and try and uncover the island's secrets.
Yeah, it kind of feels like an open-world mist, doesn't it?
Yeah.
But before you can start to question the meaning of it all, you stumble across one of these terminals, where you'll find one of the hundreds of puzzles that are scattered across the island.
And with the exception of a few environmental puzzles, every puzzle is based around these mazes, where you guide a line from one point to an exit without it crossing itself. It sounds simple, but a better word would be elegant, because it is incredible just how much variety and difficulty they have designed around that one concept.
As you explore the island, you'll find new areas, which add in various rules that completely change how you approach each maze. But I won't talk specifics, because figuring out what they mean is a big part of the joy in the problem solving. But generally speaking, there are different symbols that tell you how to solve it, or you look for a clue within the environment.
When you complete the main puzzles in an area, you'll activate a laser beam that shoots up to a mountaintop. Once you've activated 7 of these lasers, you'll unlock the final area, but there are actually more than 7 of them, so you don't have to solve everything to get to the end.
And some areas are particularly tough, so it's good you have the option to skip them if they're proving too hard.
Generally, I think they've done a pretty good job with how they introduce you to each new concept gradually and layer on the complexity. It never holds your hand, but it also gives you all the information you need to know. Sometimes you may stumble into a maze before you've been taught the rules, but that just means you'll need to explore the island a little bit further and find the puzzles that'll teach you what you need to know.
I always liked finding a new area and getting my head around a new concept, partly because that process of realization is so satisfying, but also because the first bunch of mazes are usually quite easy, so I'd find myself ticking off mazes and feeling like a genius. Then inevitably one comes along that completely shatters that illusion and makes me feel like a complete idiot. It's just a line through a bloody maze. How hard can it be?
Yeah, but it's because the rules keep changing. It's so frustrating. I don't think I've ever played a game that has made me feel so smart and so stupid at the same time. My phone is full of photos and my room is just littered with the scribblings of a madwoman just trying to get through some of these.
Yeah, it's maddening. Especially when you know what you have to do, but you just can't quite see how it's possible. And then you do figure it out and you go, how did I not see that? Although I do think some of the mazes jumped ahead by a few degrees of difficulty too quickly, and I was left feeling like they hadn't really explained the mechanics.
Yeah, I think that's kind of a brilliant part of the process, though. You know, I like the devs put their trust in my ability to put the pieces together and, you know, have my own epiphany.
Well, in my case, that trust was often misplaced.
Well, you know, you can always just try some other area of the island.
Well, you say that, Hex. But there was this one bit where I got stuck on a maze and I didn't realise I could go back the way I came, and the only other way out was through a door with a different maze that I couldn't solve. So I was trapped in a box of my own inadequacy, Hex.
You must be used to that by now, Barcher.
I am, but it never gets any easier.
So what did you do? You rage quit?
No, even worse, I used a guide.
But we've all been there.
There's only for one solution. Yeah. Just one solution. Got my head around the mechanic and it helped me get unstuck, so.
Yeah, I have to admit there are a few puzzles that I just could not figure out how to solve. I'm sure they have solutions, but for the life of me, I could not see how I was supposed to figure it out, and I just ended up brute forcing my way past them by guessing every solution.
Yeah, speaking of guessing, I didn't quite like it how sometimes a failed attempt would deactivate a puzzle, and that would force you to go back to a previous maze to reactivate it. I guess they're trying to discourage you from wildly guessing, but it just seemed like a pointlessly annoying thing to do when you need to use a bit of trial and error. It's just a small complaint, really.
I haven't had this much fun with a puzzle game in a long time. Getting to the solutions and unlocking each area of the island was just so satisfying. And there are so many little mysteries and secrets here, and some puzzles don't even seem to do anything, but you just know there's something going on. You can potentially lose a lot of your life to this game, so beware.
What do you think of the story and the sort of mystery of the island?
I mean, I'm sure there is some kind of meaning, but I couldn't figure it out.
Yeah, not on the surface, at least. A lot of it felt like I was in some modern minimalist art museum. It's all very pretty and interesting, and I know it has some sort of deeper significance and meaning, but I have no idea what that is.
Yeah, the closest you'll get to a story are some audio logs lying around.
Of all the communities available to us, there's not one I would want to devote myself to.
And a little cinema that has some clips of a BBC documentary that you can unlock.
Well, that's no better a solution than any of the others, is it?
They're thought-provoking, but I couldn't really piece together any deeper meaning from them. Although maybe provoking thought was the whole point of the game. What are you giving it, Barjo?
Well, this is about as clever as a puzzle game can get. It's beautiful, it's unique. I'm giving it 4 stars.
Yeah, I think this is one of the most simplest and yet complex games I've ever played. I loved it. I'm giving it 4.5.
That will leave those of us who don't have access to it as powerless as if we were deaf, dumb, and blind. And I don't think most people want that. So what do we do about it? I don't know.
What happens when you put dozens of indie game developers under the one roof every day of the week?
You get something like the hive of activity that is the arcade. Here's Goose to explain more.
Ah, good old Melbourne, the cultural and sporting centre of Australia. Home to the MCG, the Yarra River, a working tram system, and far superior coffee. But what you may not know is that it also houses a unique indie dev hub, the Arcade, that boasts some of Australia's most talented and successful game companies.
The Arcade is a collaborative workspace for game developers, and specifically indie game developers. It was created as a home, a place where they could get together, they could collaborate, and have all this creative knowledge in one place and work together.
Can you tell me, first of all, where did you get the idea from?
2010, I wrote the original pitch for the Arcade, and it was I actually did a lot of homework on MIT's Building 20 during the war and what they did to extend that, and then looked at the Pixar model as well, which is actually loosely based on the same thing, and saw what happened when you got very like-minded people together. And the industry, the Australian industry, was really fragmented at the time. And I started thinking, well, if we had a space where we had creative, like-minded people, what could happen?
It is an office, but it's an office for 15, 20 game development companies, like up to 80 people. Game development companies usually don't work together, like you're usually not in the same space.
So having this space just means everyone can come together and there's like an even stronger sense of community within Melbourne.
Getting funding for the Arcade originally was actually quite challenging. We did a big feasibility study. We went to government and asked them to support it. Everybody was pretty much on board until the 11th hour, and then the whole deal collapsed. But then we had this critical mass of developers that really wanted to do it. So the GDA put in a bit of money. We actually negotiated with the landlord of this building and told him the vision, and he actually helped us out. You know, we had this tiered rental structure where we started at a really, really low rental rate, and it allowed us to build up over time. We originally opened the doors in 2013, September 1st, 2013, so we just had our second birthday party.
So the Voxel agents were here right at the beginning of the Arcade. Can you tell me a bit about that?
When we heard that the Game Developers Association was setting up the Arcade, we kind of pounced on that idea because, you know, we wanted to find, like, a good shared working experience that was in the city and with cool people to work with.
I helped move in a lot of the furniture before the Arcade actually started. I knew Tony before the Arcade was up and running, and the Tin Man Games was one of the first of 3 companies in the building.
And Big Ant was here downstairs, and these 2 floors were just full of furniture, and it was just, it was crap. But it was an empty space, and we could move in. And so we approached Tony and we said, you know, can we sort of come in here and we'll split the rent, and, you know, we can, like, get a coffee machine and, like, we could have, like, a real office.
That's an office, I think, that's officially.
An office, yeah. And that's kind of how it sort of kicked off and started. And so we all just kind of, like, moved in on a Saturday and then we're up and running on a Monday.
And we allowed it to grow organically. We didn't try to pile people in. Culturally, that works. People have come in, they've become assimilated with the Arcade and know all the people. So it's not long before you join the Arcade that you get to know everybody. And once you have that, you have that knowledge base and that helpline whenever you need it.
What would you say are some of the advantages of having a space like the Arcade to work within?
Yeah, it's really great. Like coming in and you know, just having other developers around, other people who are in the same, you know, headspace, same problems, as well as being able to, you know, lean on people, you know, could you maybe you could help me out with a bit of work today. I'm a little bit snowed under. Yeah, it's really great.
It's very easy to get information from people if you're having a problem with a question or you can't work out some code or something like that, or you need a quick bit of art. It's easy just to walk down the hallway, ask someone, see if they're free, and get some help from them.
You cannot underestimate the power of, like, just social interaction within these spaces. But you have this free-flowing area where people can walk between their offices, and they're going to the kitchen, and they're going to the break room, and they're just, like, walking up and down the stairs, and people cross paths and they talk. That's really where all of the strength of the building comes from.
We have a lot of connections, so we have a lot of, just because we're a label and we talk to a lot of people overseas and we talk to platforms and media and so on, so we can bring a lot to the developers, I guess, by helping connect them with those, but then they're fantastic to kind of run questions by on the creative side and what do you think about this game.
Every now and then Fridays we have like a feedback Friday, so like we go and sit in the boardroom and you play other people's games and they can give you feedback that you don't normally get from the public.
I mean, just with Shooty Skies, you know, like when we first started making it, I made the prototype in a couple of days. I would just sort of wander around and be like, hey, you know, play my game, and I just watch them play it, you know, and that's the best way to make a game, is to constantly have people play it and watch them play it, and having just this sort of huge resource of people who are, one, knowledgeable and into the games and give you really good sort of professional feedback is hugely important.
How do you go about keeping it all under control?
It works because everyone gets along really well, everyone's friends, and everyone just sort of respects everyone else, so it really looks after itself. Essentially, you just keep the coffee machine stocked and everybody else is pretty happy. I mean, everybody plays board games together. There was someone swapping tomato seeds the other day for their veggie patch. It's just such a great community. People just help each other out. If anyone has a problem, there's a Facebook group. People just jump on, ask their question, and someone will be down the hall in a minute and just answering their question. It's amazing.
Would you say on the flip side, are there any challenges to having this many creative people around in one space?
I think distraction's the biggest challenge, because there's always something really amazing happening, and sometimes you just need to knuckle down and just get some tedious work done. Mm. It's kind of hard when you're like, this one's got a new game idea and it's amazing and you want to go play it, but you really need to get work done.
The major problem is, like, everybody argues about the dishwasher. Like, that's generally how it works, right?
Right.
You know.
As you've had people join and be successful, people like Hipster Whale downstairs, how has that impacted the space and the people who work here?
I mean, when you see that success, there's this huge amount of positivity. It's not, nobody begrudges success in our sector. Everybody's really happy for people who succeed. And, you know, within a space like this, it obviously motivates. Mm. And then you'll have the hipster guys talking quite openly to everybody that wants to talk to them about what they've done and their experiences. And that helps everybody else. You know, it lifts your game that little bit more every single time.
And because you have so many different companies that target so many different, you know, markets and products and things, no one is competing against one another, and everyone actually wants everyone else to succeed. Because if one person does well, it kind of lifts everybody up. So, I mean, the classic example is Crossy Road. Like, Matt and Andy have this huge success, but they need some help. So Mighty Games comes in and we're like, well, we can help you out. And so we start doing some production work for them, and at the same time we're developing our own game. And so the lessons that they've learnt there are shared with us. So Crossy Road kind of like spawns Shooty Skies.
We're not precious about our ideas or our IP. It's like, you can't see what I'm working on. That doesn't exist. Occasionally there's a, you can't tell anyone what I'm working on, but within the arcade we share everything.
We share a lot at the various meetups and like Melbourne Games Week, it's happening right now. We all get together and share experiences. So all of us sort of together are sort of trying to help everyone out, you know, it's like us against the world kind of thing.
Do you think something like the arcade is a model that needs to be expanded upon, grown upon, and see more of them in the future?
Yeah, definitely. I think we've already had interest in Auckland to have a repeat of the arcade, and other states as well are interested in doing something, so we're really hoping this will expand.
I'd like to see more arcades, well, certainly in every Australian city, and we're already having those conversations. We'd like to see the arcade set up because we've proven the model. The really interesting thing about it, though, is your development community has to be having the right conversation. And that's what it was in Melbourne at the time. There was the right conversation of a community that wanted to be together, that wanted to support each other. And those conversations are now starting to happen in other states. So we've shown that we can be collaborative, that we've lost that ego, we've lost that sense of privacy that, you know, I think the old industry had with, you know, don't copy my homework because you might see my idea. Whereas here, somebody will put an idea on a piece of paper and go, what do you think? Will it grow? I really hope so. I mean, wouldn't it be nice if we saw more interaction from those bigger development studios and being willing to share the knowledge you have and solve problems? Games would be made that much faster and they'd be so much better.
Thanks, Goose. When we experience trauma or hardship, it's human nature to want to work through that pain through a creative outlet. And so many deeply personal stories have been told through literature and film. But there's something much more visceral about accessing that struggle firsthand through a video game, isn't there?
Absolutely. You're suddenly so much more involved. It forces you to feel more connected to the events as they play out, as if it was happening to you. Such is the case with That Dragon Cancer, developed by the small team at Numinous Games.
The team is led by Ryan and Amy Green, who lost their infant son, Joel, to cancer and chose this game to be the vessel through which they told their story, along with an accompanying documentary due for release later this year.
Is Nick crying?
The first thing that struck me about this game was the use of live voice recordings.
Well, Isaac, you gotta give him little pieces. He doesn't understand.
Ryan and Amy have recorded their own voices and the conversations they have with their children to paint the picture of their family life as they endure this illness.
It's a punch in the stomach, isn't it? Just the reality of it. The game takes the form of a point-and-click style adventure as you play out scenes of a sort of surreal, dreamlike journey through Joel's illness.
You're out.
Do you know how they celebrate off-treatment day, like when kids are done with their treatments? I guess maybe you don't because you're not in the clinic as much as I am, but on someone's last day, they always bring them a cake and they sing happy off-therapy day to you. Anyway, that happened today. I mean, it happens a lot, but today I cried.
The art style is simple and muted, relying more on shapes and metaphors, which work well because it's kind of like sifting through memories and their associated emotions.
In a practical sense, I do wish the navigation was a bit more free. The whole game is on rails and you're instructed to click your way from one place to another. You can choose the order in which you approach certain scenes and objects, but in general, I'd prefer to be less passively led around the environment.
I absolutely agree. It feels frustrating and confining, but it's games like this where you're more comfortable with forgiving that kind of choice. Because this aims to tell a very specific story. You are in many ways in a kind of theme park ride through this family's experience with cancer.
You know a scary lion? It's so loud.
Yeah, that's a good way to describe it, and yet it's so much more involving than just watching a film. Because even the simple clicks you do to instigate calming a child in pain, or trying to stop a father from feeling like he's drowning, it's harrowing.
Stop. Please.
Especially when your attempts are futile.
Yeah, it's an incredible way to explain what that feeling must be like. And so much of this game is about expressing that sense of helplessness. The endless love and care you have, the longing to protect your child, the will to fight, ultimately feels helpless against this dragon.
The other major theme in this game is religion. Both devout Christians, Ryan and Amy, are completely transparent and open about the presence of their faith during the awful experience they are going through.
Yeah, and you know, that's rarely something that's touched on so openly in games. But there's no religious agenda here, it's simply a big part of their story. And I found it added a lot to this. The trust and faith they have that God will heal and save their baby.
I just really believe he'll be healed. I know you believe too, just when you act like that, I get all unsure.
Alongside the struggles they face to reconcile themselves with God's plan if he doesn't survive.
I'm pleading for God to spare his life. And I'm tempted to despair because self-inspection leads me to conclude I shouldn't expect much of anything. And yet my wife is expecting a surprise party from the Lord.
It's heartbreaking, and you're with them every step of the way as they try to make sense of it.
I have so many things stirring around in my spirit that I have to write to settle myself and find God's wisdom in the midst of chaos. I'm scared I won't be strong enough to face the things we might have to face in the coming weeks and months.
And try and explain it to their children, which were some of the most powerful moments for me.
Oh, just the metaphor of the dragon as the cancer.
That dragon's going to kill Joel. Joel's going to lose.
Why do you say that?
Because Joel is just a baby. Babies can't kill dragons.
This played out in a very clever side-scrolling platformer as a device to explain what is happening to Joel to their other children. I mean, that moment, for me, just elevated this whole game beyond artistic storytelling.
Me too. There is such strong imagery in this game, and while there have been many experiences with this horrible illness told in many different ways, this little indie game is one of the most unique and affecting that I've come across.
Is it technically great? No, it's a little awkward and there are moments that feel repetitive. But that doesn't prevent it from creating an incredibly deep connection with the player because of the choices they've made and just how deeply, deeply personal a story it is. I'm giving it 4 out of 5 stars.
I'm giving it 4 stars as well.
I would also recommend having someone to hug directly after you play this. Don't play it alone before you go to bed at night or something.
Yeah, absolutely. I spent some quality time with the cats after this, just sobbing into their fluffy bodies.
Well, every week in the Good Game Office, our team ends up in a passionate discussion on all the latest happenings and issues that affect us as gamers.
So Goose has put together a new weekly segment to highlight these hot topics and shower them with his sometimes informed and sometimes balanced opinion.
This is Goose's IMO.
Thanks, guys. To kick things off this week, I want to talk about the words Let's Play. Specifically, I want to talk about how Sony recently tried and failed to trademark them. Yes, Sony found itself making headlines across the gaming world after the United States Patent and Trademark Office shot down their application to trademark the term Let's Play.
We don't do cases like that because it's ridiculous.
Firstly, they refused the application because it was similar to an existing trademark for something called LP Let's Play. But US law firm the MacArthur Law Firm, which specializes in video game law, yes, apparently video game law is an actual thing.
This is as real as it gets.
Well, they didn't think the trademark was denied for the right reason. No, they hadn't gone far enough. They filed a petition saying that it should be denied because the words Let's Play are too widely used and generic to be trademarked. The USPTO agreed, the internet rejoiced. And people can now continue to make Let's Plays free from the fear of the dreaded knock on the door by Sony's hired goons.
Hired goons?
But the real question is, why? Why on earth did Sony try to trademark Let's Play? I mean, they don't even make Let's Plays. Well, while I don't know the answer, the cynic in me can't help but assume it's because Let's Plays are huge business. Type it into YouTube and you get about 34 million results. Last year, PewDiePie alone ranked in $12 million from his 40 million subscribers who love nothing more than watching him do stuff like this.
Go! Go! He keeps going! Make me proud, boy! You did it, son! You did it! I'm proud of you!
Games like Goat Simulator and I Am Bread seem to be almost entirely designed around the fact they'd make good Let's Play videos. In fact, Skate 3 actually got reprinted after surging in popularity due to Let's Play videos. So they're a powerful marketing tool and a cultural phenomenon that seems to have found its way into mainstream media.
Be sure to subscribe to my channel if you haven't already, because subscribing makes you feel good!
Why wouldn't Sony want to own that? But no matter what their intentions were, it never feels right when people try to take ownership over a common word or phrase like that. Another recent example was when the Fine Brothers, makers of reaction videos, tried to trademark the word react. Well, people reacted by unsubscribing from their channel in the millions.
Your music's bad and you should feel bad.
And of course, gaming and trademark battles are a dime a dozen. Just this year, we've seen the words Unravel and Ghost come under dispute, while words such as Scrolls, Trenched, and even Edge have all been hotly contested at one point or another. And while there were half-rational claims in those cases, it always comes across as petty and frankly stupid when we hear these stories. It's policing our language to an uncomfortable degree.
In fact, no Star Trek episode contains the words beam me up, Scotty.
Ah! Ow, ow, my arm! Ah! Ow!
So, sorry, Sony, let's not play this game. But that's just my opinion. Do you agree? Disagree? Do you even care at all? Well, let us know via social media on Twitter or Facebook, and each week we'll take those responses and chat about them on the following day's episode of Pocket.
Oh, hex, my eyes hurt, and my back hurts, and my neck hurts, and my wrist hurts, and I haven't slept for days. What's wrong with me?
It's a new XCOM game, Barjo.
That's it. Shall we kick some alien butt?
Good game, team!
Team Good Game, the world needs you. The alien menace is greater than ever. Humanity is on the brink of extinction. You are the best of the best. the world's last hope. Report in.
Marjo McGoodgame reporting for duty. Ready to roll out.
Goose here. Locked and loaded.
I am reporting for the duty time. By hangers.
NichBoy here. Let's do this.
Hex McGoodgame. I'm a sniper.
In 2012, developer Firaxis Games brought us the excellent and all-consuming turn-based strategy game XCOM Enemy Unknown. It was a reboot of sorts for the long-running series where you defended against alien invaders one turn at a time.
XCOM 2 is set 20 years later, and whether you won the last game or not, now you're on the run.
Prepare for the 20th anniversary of Unification Day.
Could never break the bond between humanity and the Elders.
Yes, Earth surrendered, and now all the aliens are setting up shop. Alien-human hybrids known as Advent form an oppressive security force which keep humans in check. Step out of line and you're done for.
It's your job as commander to rebuild the XCOM organization and mount a resistance before it's too late. This is a game about starting from scratch against the odds, building up your mobile base and technology.
It's perfect.
And eventually going on the final assault with a well-geared group of soldiers who have all been through the trenches and earned their stripes.
I like this setup, Barjo, dropping into zones to rescue humans.
You're good to go. Move.
Taking out alien factories or alien technology.
Catch. Destroy that relay at all costs.
You're on the attack now, and that has more drive to it.
Hit it there now.
They've worked hard to give the story more kick this time too, so it's more exciting.
Yeah, there's more cutscenes and chatter, which is great at first, but that story does start to drag after a while. Not even Optimus Prime can save it.
Advent has been diverting considerable resources and personnel to covert facilities across the globe.
In between ground attacks, you'll be in the war room, which is a whole huge strategy game in itself. Here, you make decisions on where to spend your time, reaching out to the resistance forces or setting up ways to earn cash and more.
Avenger plotting new course.
But whenever you feel like you're just getting things under control, something will happen and you'll have to scramble to fight with whatever units are available.
Sky Ranger deployed.
The aliens are hitting a resistance outpost with everything they've got. Heavy civilian casualties, Commander.
Help! No! Damn it, no! You can never catch a break, and the whole time you're just watching that alien progress bar and trying to get your resistance together before it fills up. Duh.
Commander, that UFO contact has us locked in.
It's wonderfully stressful. I found that whole geoscape a bit confusing at first, though. But much like the rest of this game, you just have to get in there and play, and you'll eventually pick up on what's going on.
I hope that your ongoing efforts will only lead to further success.
But even when you do understand everything, you'll still stuff up and make mistakes, and then you'll scream at the screen.
Yeah, they're kind of good screams, though, aren't they?
Oh, totally.
The missions on the ground are the real bread and butter, though.
Getting it done.
They often have some kind of secondary objective or turn counter ticking away in the corner to pile on the stress. It's a little like a time limit, but not annoying in that way.
Menace 1-5, hostile interceptors are on high-speed approach. Your window for extraction is closing.
Yeah, it encourages you to take risks and push, and it really keeps the momentum of these fights going. And I think that's much better this time around, too.
We've got access. Menace 1-5, acknowledged.
The missions are dynamic as well, especially when that red smoke drops and suddenly there are alien reinforcements on the way.
I've got eyes on Advent!
Oh, it's always at the worst possible time as well, and you have to mad scramble and cover all your flanks before they land.
One new feature is concealment, where you start a mission in full stealth, and this is really helpful in setting up some powerful ambushes. I was hoping they'd feature it a little bit more, because it's an interesting way to start a map with a small advantage.
This is for you!
Confirmed.
The maps are procedurally generated now instead of being handmade. But the objects within those maps don't feel random. Everything seems more focused on being strategic and more aesthetically pleasing than the last game. There is a lot of destruction as well. It can be used to totally take out targets in some situations. It also spreads fire that can displace you or the enemy.
At least we know where they are!
There are some new soldier classes as well, and as you level up your soldiers, you get to pick from different abilities, and they're all really interesting. The Ranger has a sword which can be upgraded to stun enemies as well, and I found this really valuable for heading into the thick of a fight and taking out one enemy before they get a turn. Not necessarily the toughest enemy on the battlefield, but the most disruptive.
Yeah, it's very much about controlling the battlefield at all times, isn't it?
Yeah. Infiltrating their system!
I love the Specialist class, which has a gremlin drone that can hack objectives remotely, and is also very good for disabling mechanoids and trooper shields.
Those gremlins have such range, and they can be used to heal your units or protect them at times, but what I use them the most for was just finishing off that one enemy on low health.
Yeah, and that happens all the time, doesn't it, where you don't hit quite as hard as you thought you would. It's also great that there are multiple hacking options, but if you fail, it can buff the enemy, which is the worst.
Yeah, this game is full of tough decisions like that.
Personally, I never go into battle without a good sniper. They're now called sharpshooters and are much more versatile this time around thanks to some deadly pistol perks. Plus, there are weapon mods now too, which add another layer of delicious customization.
This XCOM is only on PC this time around, which is a shame for console owners, and developer Firaxis have said it's for development and technical reasons. It does look great on PC though. The action camera is really exciting and always great to watch, but there are still a few rough edges. I didn't find the presentation overall very smooth. Some of the camera angles and visuals also make maneuvering inside buildings tricky, and animations are still a little glitchy at times. Pretty much everything you do in this game is based on a dice roll with a percentage chance to hit, so every now and then you do see bullets going at right angles.
Yeah, it always looks strange when you're in a square right next to an enemy and they miss. He was right there! It can be hard to believe those high percentage failures sometimes.
Yeah, but it's still incredibly compelling turn-based strategy. The controls are easy to master, the two-phase move and attack system makes sense straight away. And the more you research and rank up your soldiers, the more interesting everything gets. And you're always improving, always learning.
Yeah, and that's what makes it so consistently fun as well. When you take a diverse group of ranked soldiers out into the field and suddenly start making all these strategic connections in the heat of battle,
yeah, that difficulty curve is perfect. And I think that's a big step up from the last game, which I found got way too easy pretty quickly. With XCOM 2, as you get more skills and strategies, the game constantly throws new problems for you to solve.
We'll need to look for vulnerabilities if we're going to take that thing out.
Consequently, each mission feels different.
You have to make tough decisions on who to let go, too. No matter how good you are at placing your units behind cover or setting up Overwatch to keep enemies from overwhelming you, you'll always get busted and flanked and units will die. It's just devastating when things go wrong and you lose your best soldiers.
It's so hard to fight that urge to just reload a save file when somebody dies. I wish I'd started this game with Iron Man mode enabled, but I was just too scared. I can't be trusted without it.
Well, that is the way to go for the true XCOM experience. No do-overs in Iron Man mode means every move is more considered, and there's a real emotional pang when a veteran soldier dies.
People down here.
Tell my kids,
Oh, my Goose was so bad, Hex. He just kept dying.
That didn't feel good.
Utter trash. In fact, the more he died in-game, the more I started to resent him in real life.
Hey, Bardo.
Get your shit together, Goose!
Why?
I think the best thing you can do for your playthrough is make all of your characters look like people you know.
Oh, absolutely. It's just like the Sims games, right? Watching your friends fight and die digitally is just so much fun. There's even some True Blue Ocker Aussie accents in there.
Solid copy.
Copy that.
Ah,
Target neutralized.
Looks like something over here.
We did have a quick look at multiplayer, but it was a bit of a laggy, buggy mess, and maybe it was just bad luck, Hex, but it certainly didn't encourage us to go back to it and give it another go.
Is one of you guys dead? Did you just fall over dead? Is that lag?
They got me.
What happened?
Final thoughts?
Well, personally, I would have liked a few more options to maybe speed up the action and unlock the camera a little bit. But this is a more complex and deeper game than Enemy Unknown, and it will lead to obsession. You'll shout with joyous victory 1 minute and then be crying into your hands the next. It's 4 stars from me.
I was expecting a bit more polish. There are those rough edges that we've talked about, but also I don't care because this is so compelling. It's all I can think about. Every single move you make in this game is a calculated gamble, and when it pays off, you feel so good. I'm giving it 4.5 stars.
Adjusting EM.
They finally did it, Hex. After all these years, they shut down the G-files.
I don't think so, Bajo. I'm pretty sure we were just on Christmas break. We just filmed an episode then.
Did we, Hex? Or was it alien-human hybrids in clone bodies controlled by bees pulling all the strings?
No, I'm pretty sure we were on break, and we just filmed an episode.
That's their game, Hex, and you just named it.
It was Darkest of Days on PC from 2009. This sci-fi first-person shooter put you at the scene as some of the most terrible moments in history, tasking you with helping key historical figures survive in order to uphold the continuity of the past. Love a bit of time travel, and it was our name the game for this week because it was co-developed by Josh Larson, one of the designers behind this week's That Dragon Cancer.
Well, we hope you've enjoyed being back with the Good Game team this week. We have a massive year ahead, and next week the deluge of gaming continues as we go on a most intriguing first-person adventure in Firewatch.
Wait, you're already there? You're not in your tower?
No, I'm not.
Then who is?
And unleash some Fist of Fury in Street Fighter V. Don't forget the Good Game Spawn Point returns to ABC 3 this weekend, where we'll bash some bricks in LEGO Marvel Avengers.
Loki is beyond reason, but he is my brother. He's adopted.
And playing some Mario and Luigi Paper Jam Brothers.
And of course, NichBoy is on your internets 5 days a week with Good Game Pocket, which you can watch on iView.
So far, all Yanni really does is just play with childhood play equipment. Like, he's pushing blocks around, he's bobbing for apples, he's riding bikes, he's slowly disintegrating as he walks too far away from his mother. It's classic childhood.
Until next time, may all your games be good ones. Hex out.
Baju out. How long are you going to wear this?
One more week.
This little sandal. Your magic sandal. Looks comfy though.
Yeah. I'm excited to get rid of it.
Yeah.
Limpy, limpy, there she goes. Limpy, limping all. I don't know the rest.
You're creating your own theme song?